3.5 years ago, my daughter's band teacher, who was a music director at my church, asked me to play violin in the small church orchestra. So I said, yes. I borrowed the violin, but my husband did not like the idea of borrowing a very expensive violin. So he bought me one. I got, oops, I have no excuse now. I have to play. So now I enjoy playing, and it is a tribute to my mother who made me, forced me, but now I play it out of pure enjoyment and mostly to praise God. When I play in church orchestra, I am praising God for all the good things that He has done in my life. And I would like to read the song that I'm going to be playing, 10,000 Reasons, Bless the Lord, O My Soul. I'm not a good singer, so I'm just going to read, and I'm going to play. Many of you know this song, but the words really touch me, so I really wanted to play on my violin. Bless the Lord, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your praise, Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness, I will keep on singing 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending, 10,000 years and then forevermore. Jesus, I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I worship Your holy name.
Thank you. Good afternoon and welcome to the Island Church of Whidbey. We are all here this afternoon to celebrate the life of the incomparable Sue Parrick. Later on in the service, we're going to have a time to share a little bit about what life meant, what Sue meant to us in our life. So I'm going to share my thoughts for that time. But just now, would you guys get on your feet this afternoon so we can pray and address the Lord and get this service started. Jesus, we are grateful to be able to celebrate the life of Sue this afternoon, Lord. Lord, we pray for your presence to be among us this afternoon, Lord, and we pray, Lord, that you would guide our hearts, that you would meet us, that you would comfort the grieving, that you would be with those who are mourning, Lord, and that you would be able to just allow us, Lord, to engage in all of that by the power of your Spirit, Lord. We commit this service to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Sue loved the word. She was involved with precept studies, and years ago, she and Lindy Benjamin led precept for, I can't remember how many years, and in the last 15 years, we've had precept going again. Precept is an in-depth study of God's word, and she has been a faithful student of his word. For my 70th birthday, she gave me this little sheep, and when the card next to it, she says, Marilyn, we need to remember, we need to be like the sheep, sitting at the feet of Jesus and feeding on his very word. I'm so thankful that I have this reminder of Sue and her love for his word. So the family has asked me to share some scriptures with you. First one is in Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. And in Romans 15:13, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And then in Philippians 1:9-11, and this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in real knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve the things that are excellent in order to be sincere and blameless until the day of Christ, having been filled with the fruit of righteousness, which comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. And then in Romans 8:37, but in all things we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created things will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And then in Isaiah 41:13. For I am the Lord your God, who upholds your right hand, who says to you, do not fear, I will help you. Thank you.
Afternoon. Excuse me. I think we know most of you out there, but those of you who don't know us, I'm Scott Iverson, my wife KK, and our son Jeremy, and we began here many years ago. It's great to be back here and see so many faces that come to honor Sue. And we are certainly honored to be able to share a song right now. Steve, family, and what Sue has meant to us, and boy, Steve and Sue were the first people, probably one of the first people that we connected with when we moved down here. They became the surrogate grandparents to our kids. Were always there for us, and I know they always will be. And I just want to read this verse that kind of sets the stage for this song. It's a wonderful psalm. It says, I will lift my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. You know what all means? I looked it up. All means all. That's all means, just so you know that. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. That's great news. Great, great news.
God, my God, I cry out, your beloved needs you now. God, be near, calm my fear, and take my doubt. Your kindness is what pulls me up. Your love is all that draws me in. I will lift my eyes to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging wild. I will lift my eyes to the healer of the hurt I hold inside. I will lift my eyes, lift my eyes to you. And God, my God, let mercy sing her melody over me. And God, right here, all I bring is all of me. Your kindness is what pulls me up. Your love is all that draws me in. I will lift my eyes to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging wild. I will lift my eyes to the healer of the hurt I hold inside. I will lift my eyes, lift my eyes to you. 'Cause you are and you were and you will be forever the lover I need to save me. 'Cause you fashioned the earth and you hold it together, God. So hold me now. I will lift my eyes to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging wild. I will lift my eyes to the healer of the hurt I hold inside. I will lift my eyes, lift my eyes to you. I will lift my eyes, lift my eyes God, my God, I cry out. Your beloved needs you now.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Matt Chambers. Many of you know me, pastor of the Assembly of God Church, and had the opportunity to be with Steve and family members during the, you know, these last days and weeks. And they asked me to, you know, to share today. And part of what I want to do is I sat down with them. And I said, okay, so Steve and some other the kids were there saying, what would other people want to know about Sue? You know, there's a formal, you know, kind of description of her life in the program there. But what are some of the other things that people might want to know? So here's some things that you might not know about Sue, and they're not necessarily in order. They're just, you know, it's just things they rattled out one thing after another, and I took notes, and so here's how they go. She had an incredible sense of humor. She was always pulling practical jokes. They said she short-sheeted beds, she TP'd houses with kids. Some of you were probably recipients of that and were mad at the kids, but not, you didn't know Sue was involved in it. She forked lawns. Do you guys know what forking lawns are? So you take plastic forks, like a big old Costco box of plastic fork, and just go out in their lawn and just start sticking forks everywhere, and then they have to clean them up. Until a year ago, when she could, she would catch Steve off guard, and she would spray him with the sprayer from the sink. Steve sent me a note, I don't know whether it was last night or early this morning, and he had this line. He said, no hose was safe in her hands, summer or winter. And that meant if you were near her, near a hose, you weren't safe either, is what he's actually saying. So she was very competitive. In high school, there was no sports. So in ninth grade, they had a field day at the school she was attending, and she set out to beat all the boys and girls, and she did. She would swim regularly at Silver Lake, and even though she was afraid of heights, she was so competitive that she went off the high dive just so she could show other people up. She had an uncle, Uncle Bill, who was a pastor, and at VBS, she learned all the verses and won a trip to summer camp. She was so excited about being able to go, but her dad wasn't going to let her go. So Uncle Bill went over to the house and argued with her dad, and she ended up going to camp, and it was at camp that she committed her life to follow Jesus. And the rest of Sally's story that she didn't tell is that when Sue was about 10 years old, she received a message from God that she was to adopt a Korean girl. And so then Steve didn't know that until he was leaving for Korea. If I have all the facts right, he didn't know that until he was leaving for Korea. And the last words Sue spoke to him as he was getting on the plane was, bring me back a Korean girl. And so Steve, not because of that, but Steve started going to an orphanage along with a bunch of other soldiers, and every day went, and thus we have Sally. You know, when she, a couple more things that they told about Sally, I guess because you weren't here to meet with me, but when she, Sue always looked young for her age. And when someone says that, that is always good for a woman. So if someone says that about you, man, just, thank you. So she always looked young, and so when Sue was in high school, she went to school, when one of her kids was in high school, Sue went to school to talk to the principal, and the principal looked at her and told her to get back to class. And then another time, she was with one of the kids, and the bus driver, thinking she was a student, told her to get back, to get on the bus. And it was up until just about a year ago, it was common for an attendant at the ferry booth to ask her to see the driver's license to give her a senior discount. That's a good thing. You know, it really is a good thing. She always pushed her kids to do something new or challenging. As Sally said, she wanted to quit the violin. Sue wouldn't let her. She told one of her kids, if this room isn't picked up, when I get home, I'm throwing stuff out. And when the child came home, the stuff was in the front lawn, just like she said. She fiercely defended her kids. She didn't give up on people. She believed in the power of the Word of God, as Marilyn already said. And if someone was antagonistic towards the gospel, you know, that they ran into somewhere, she would make it her mission to give that person a Bible. And then she would tell that person, read Mark or, you know, or John. And more than one person over the years came to faith from her giving them a Bible, even though they were antagonistic towards the faith. They said her mom always attracted kids and would have good news clubs at their house with 30 and 40 kids. There were so many kids that wanted to talk to her mom that her mom would actually set a little timer. She had a bench, and she would set a timer, and the kid only got as much time as that timer. Wouldn't it being just like, okay, next, and someone else would fall in line. Sue inherited that kid thing from her mom. At Silver Lake Church, there was always kids around. She was a part of big neighborhood water fights when they lived over there. At the end of the year, they always had sixth grade class parties at their house, full-on water games. She was a campfire leader, sewed with the girls, made Korean costumes, learned special dances. They camped at Orcas Island, where she cooked everything over an open fire. And one of the things that Steve mentioned was she loved middle schoolers. And you got to be a special person. I mean, like, there's a special place, you know, in heaven for people who love middle schoolers. She did. 50 years she worked with middle schoolers. And she loved them. She always attracted troubled kids. The family had exchange students from Mexico and New Zealand and Germany and Japan. She was involved in starting the middle school Mondays here at Island Church when she saw middle school kids walking by here, heading into Langley, as they said, to get into trouble. And she said, we've got to do something about that. And so they started, you know, the middle school Mondays. They attended the first Life Youth Conference of the CMA. One time they were at Long Beach, and Steve said they were going to run the turkey trot, and there was all kinds of people mingling around before the race started. He said maybe 1,000 people. And all of a sudden they noticed this couple go running through the crowd, frantically running through the crowd, you know, kind of what's going on. And then Sue noticed this little girl that somebody was trying to grab. And she realized what was going on, and she went over and she actually was, you know, grabbed that little child and took it to the organizer's tent and, you know, probably saved that little child from someone grabbing it. And she just loved kids, and kids loved her. She was always out for an adventure, never said no. The family attended the opening of Disneyland. They met Walt Disney. Steve and Sue traveled to 38 countries. Many of you already know that. And when they were in Macedonia, she plumbed a 3-story building on that mission trip. They rode their bikes. Steve and Sue rode their bikes often. They would go to Oak Harbor and have lunch, and they'd ride back. Once a year in September, they'd go on a bike ride down to Puyallup, Sumner. And they would leave here in the morning. They would ride their bikes to Bothell. They'd have breakfast. They went to Renton and had lunch, and they went to Sumner and had dinner. Now, I don't know if it was about the bike ride or about the meals, but they rode 87 miles. And so one year, they rode the Centennial Trail, and sometimes the Centennial Trail over Marysville, if you're familiar with it, and they would ride up and back, and then they go, what the heck, let's just do it again. And they'd ride up and back again. And they rode the American Trail down in Sacramento, they rode across Iowa, they had never ridden 100 miles. 100 miles is kind of a bicycle, you know, it's called a century, and it's a big deal for cyclists. And they never ran an actual 100 miles. So they set out one day, and they just said, we're going to ride 100 miles. And they just rode till their odometer clicked 100 miles. And so they were always doing, you know, adventurous. Friendship was forever. Sue and her siblings were always touching, laughing, and teasing. She was close with her cousins. They're like brothers and sisters. They said the door was always open. She was never in a hurry to leave where she was. That's an interesting, just when they were talking about this, I just thought, how interesting in the world we live in where everybody's, you know, speeding to get from one place to another. She was never in a hurry. She was right in the moment, whatever was going on. She was content, they said, where she was. And she was just observing and taking everything in. She didn't give up on people. She was always walking with someone, spending time with someone, doing lunch with someone. Then they talked about she had a unique relationship with each one of the kids. You know, her relationship with every one of the kids was different. And then they said this line. They said she wasn't a grandma to all the grandkids. She was a grandma to each of the grandkids. Great line to say of a grandma or a grandpa. If one of the grandkids were into something she was interested in, she became interested in it. She would read books that they were reading, even if she didn't want to read the book. But she'd read it because they were reading it. She secretly printed the church mouse around the Island Church here. It was a newsletter about graduations and birthdays and birth announcements and something someone had done that needed celebrated. It was Facebook before Facebook, and no one knew who printed the thing. Nobody knew where it came from. It just showed up in people's mailboxes. She had an incredible sense of right and wrong. She held on to the promises of God. She was always studying the Bible and teaching the Bible. In the last couple weeks of her life, Pastor Dick gave her the promise, shared the promise with her that Marilyn actually read from Isaiah 41 that said, "For I am the Lord," I'll read it again, "For I am the Lord your God who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you." And Dick, I don't know if you know this, but she just kept holding on to that promise that you shared with her. And that was you know, an anchor for her during some difficult times. She passed away on the 8th, which was the 10th anniversary of Carl Henry coming to the island. And so those are some of the things that they thought you might want to know. You know, when Steve asked me to share and just some thoughts, I immediately knew what I wanted to share about it. And it's something, hopefully this makes sense to all of you. There is a great promise in Psalm 23. Most of us are familiar with Psalm 23. It goes like this: "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters." And then it says, "He restores my soul." We've heard it so many times. We've heard it at funerals. We've heard it all kinds of places. I want to just call your attention to that one line that says, "He restores my soul." He restores my soul. I think it's one of the greatest promises found in all of Scripture. Is the promise that Jesus restores our soul. He restores your soul. You know, the soul of man gets damaged in so many different ways. And one of the ways, and one of the most damaging things, you know, I've been pastoring a long time, and one of the most damaging things that I walk with people through pastoring is the death of a loved one. It just, and if you've lost a loved one, you this will all make total sense to you. If you haven't, someday, if you remember it, it will. But it's just one of the most damaging things to the soul of people is the loss of a loved one. You know, when someone leaves to go be with Jesus. You know, and Jesus understands the damage that's done to the soul. He understands it. You know, if you think about some of the events from Jesus' life, when Jesus' cousin John the Baptist was executed, it says immediately, when he heard the news, he immediately wanted to get away and be alone. The crowds followed him, and he was unable to do so. But he knew at that moment, the death of his cousin, it pulled at his soul. It did something to his soul. You know, when Jesus' good friend Lazarus died, it says that Jesus wept. Shortest verse in the Bible, and many of you memorized it. Jesus wept. You know why Jesus wept? Because it tore at his soul. The death of Lazarus, his friend, who he spent many times at their house, it tore at his soul. When Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he wept drops of blood because of what was happening to his soul. You know, when Simeon saw Mary and Joseph and Jesus in the temple the day Jesus was dedicated and circumcised, Simeon looked at Mary and prophesied about Jesus, and one of the things he said was, "He will pierce your soul." Talking about the death of Jesus, that when Jesus died, it would pierce Mary's very soul. You know, in a secular way, we use all kinds of terms that talk about the soul being damaged. We'll say things like this: "Man, it's like my life's falling apart. You know, I'm coming to pieces. You can't get things together. It's like I'm unraveling." All of those are secular ways that our world talks about this thing. The Bible talks about the soul coming apart. You know, your soul is the deepest part of who you are. It's the core. It's your innermost being. And since God created your soul, only God can restore your soul. You know, death has a way of unraveling a person's soul. Regardless of who the survivor is, regardless of the circumstance, death just, you know, in a sense, pulls the stuffing out of someone. And they find themselves, you know, kind of reeling. And if you've lost someone dear to you, you know what I'm talking about. Again, you know, you've experienced having death pull at the seams of your life. And, you know, that's the bad news. That's the bad news, is what death does to a soul. The good news is, and not actually the good news, the great news is that Jesus restores a person's soul. Jesus reaches in. When someone turns to Jesus for the first time, or when someone turns to Jesus for the thousandth time, it really doesn't matter. Jesus reaches in and begins a restoring process to a person's soul. If we really think about it, that's what following Jesus is all about. It's about Jesus grabbing hold of a broken person that I was in 1979 and just beginning to do a process of restoring me back to what I'm supposed to be. That's what following Jesus is really all about. And he does that in significant ways when someone's lost someone. The promise in the book of Matthew where Jesus said, come to me all who labor and are heavy laden. And when is there another time in life that we don't labor and are carrying a heavy load than when someone's died? Steve, you've carried a lot of loads, but this is your heaviest. You know, many of the family members, you've carried heavy loads, but this is a heavy load. This is might be the heaviest. But the promise in Matthew 11 is, come to me and you will find rest. And he says, rest for what? For your souls. Amen. You'll find rest for your soul. He will reach in and begin to do a healing work. Steve and I have talked about this a couple of times already. That, you know, that I use this illustration. It's like when Sue breathed her last breath and all of a sudden the reality hit. It's like somebody taking his heart and just running it through a paper shredder. And there's just all these little shreds of paper there. And it's like, what do I do with this? And if Steve tried, he might spend the rest of his life trying to put all of those pieces of his heart into some recognizable order. It might take him the rest of his life. But it won't take Jesus the rest of Steve's life to do it. Because Jesus knows exactly how to put a shredded heart back together. He knows exactly how to take someone who's been ripped and someone who, you know, has had the stuffing, you know, yanked out of them and put the stuffing right back in at the right time, in the right degree, in the right way. He knows how to do that. David said this. He said, when the cares of my heart are many, your consolations cheer my soul. And over time, Jesus mends and restores the soul and brings us to the place where we can sing, it is well, what? With my soul. Jesus does that. Remember the words from Horatio Spafford? He said, he wrote this after the death of his wife and the death of his kids, his daughters. He said, when peace like a river attendeth my way, that's what Jesus brings. When sorrows like sea billows roll, families experience that and they will experience for weeks to come. They will experience the sorrow. Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. See, here's what we know about Jesus and our souls, is Jesus cares about our souls. Jesus cares about Steve, he cares about your soul, he cares about all your kids, all the grandkids, he cares. Not only does he care, he's paying attention. We may not feel like it, but he's paying attention. God knows what's going to happen to your soul inside and what's happening in your soul. He loves you enough to touch you tenderly and gently and heal and restore your soul. He's more than capable to restore your soul. He's kind enough to want to restore your soul. And he's the only one able to restore a person's soul. And like I said to you, Steve, the other day, the prayer you just have to pray, it's probably the only prayer Steve can pray right now, is Jesus, put my soul back together. Probably the only prayer he can pray. Jesus, you got to heal my soul. You got to put my soul back together. Let's pray, and then I'm going to share a letter that Steve wrote to Sue. Jesus, I pray, and we pray together as a group that loves Sue and loves Steve, loves this family. We just pray that you do a healing work in Steve's soul and Richard's soul and Mark's soul and Susie's soul and Christy's soul and the grandkids' soul. You would just do everything that's needed to heal up all of these souls. Put the stuffing back inside of them. Put the pieces back together. Begin to put the thread that's being yanked at, begin to put it back where it needs to be. Lord, that sometime in the near future, they'll be able to say, because of your touch on their heart, your touch on their soul, they'll be able to say, it's well, it's well, it's well with my soul. So do that work inside of them. Thank you that you're going to do it. Thank you. Thank you for the incredible promise of Psalm 23, that it's the Lord who restores my soul. Thank you for that promise. Amen. This is a letter again, and then the family and others are going to share some memories. I lost it in here. Here we go. So again, this is from Steve. I love you, Susan. I love you, Susan Marie Matheson, from the first time I saw you across the room at college. Incredibly, you chose to love me back. I loved everything about you. I loved your hair, your blue eyes, your legs, your shape, the smile, but most of all, the touch. I loved how you cared about me and about others. You had a heart such as a heart for, and had such a heart for kids, tiny babies, teenagers, any size, age, or shape. We did incredible things together. We traveled to foreign countries where we had no reservations and no plans, even for the day. I loved you. I loved every part of you. You're such a wonderful teacher and a friend to grandkids and to your family. I am the person I am because of you, Susan. I remember your conviction when you told me that you were going to go away to Bible school. I was so proud of you that it caused me to love you even more. We overcame so many things, just the two of us. Whether an impossible project or an emotional teenage crisis or the road ahead that looked like a wall, through everything, you were so caring and graceful and so loving to our family and me. You always wanted to do what you thought Christ wanted you to do in your life. From the time I woke up in the morning till I laid my head down to sleep at night, and after I fell asleep, I thought about Sue and what you wanted and what you cared about, and know you did the same for me. Sometimes you couldn't make up your mind about dinner, where to live, what beach to go to, because you always wanted to do what you thought I wanted. Your sense of humor. This is a great thing here. The first morning after our honeymoon, when I got up to put my pants on to go to work, the pants were sewed at the cuffs. And it said, then he said, the smile on your face, just looking over, and the smile on your face burned into my memory all that day and every day since. For our whole life, I loved every time you gave me that smile. I loved it every time you gave me a kiss, every time you gave me a hug, every time you touched me. Sue, you cared so much about our little family. You even loved our kids before they were born. You fiercely loved two little daughters from across the world that you had never seen. You did everything possible for us to be comfortable, for us to live a life for Christ, and for us to have every opportunity. For me, you aren't just my wife, but my partner, my mate, my gift from God, my everything. You are part of every thought, every emotion, every moment. Thank you for how you love me. I thank God every day for you. He knew you before you were born and loves you and loves you through eternity. I knew from the first day I saw you that I loved you, and I will love you forever. We're apart now, but we'll be together again in heaven, and we'll celebrate forever, Steve. Great letter, Steve. Thanks for letting me share with you guys today.
Hello? We good? All right. So I'm Mark. I'm the baby. You can see that because of my size. And you can tell Sally's the oldest, right? I was thinking about what I might want to share today. Or look this way, I think. First, just want to say thank you for everyone here and the support through the years, and especially in the last, 6 months to a year for my dad, my mom, and all of us. Oh, boy. I also tried to think about some funny stories, and I realized all the funny stories were about Dad, usually set up by Mom. But she did a lot of funny things. Just because the joke wasn't on her didn't mean funny things didn't happen. If your house got TP'd, I was with her. Trust me. I think I was 3 years old. I saw Lynn Bradshaw, longtime friend. My grandmother, my mother, drug me out there to TP your house, I think for your 40th birthday or something. And she couldn't. She knew it was those two, but she couldn't figure out those little footprints. It's a funny story. Anyways, when I think about what she taught me, a legacy, I think of people. Christy said it well. She was content where she was. She invested in the people around her where she was. We were looking through pictures the last few days, as you might imagine, and so many memories from my 40 years, and some of them feel longer because I've heard the stories so many times, but it's really neat. And seeing people who I met when I was 2 and 3 years old, going everywhere with my mom, all the way up till now. And I think it's a good comment about how she loves each grandchild in their own way. She did that with all of us, too. Funny thing is, my wife, Christy, loves animals, specifically cats, which can drive some people nuts probably sometimes, but she's really into it. And one of the ways Mom connected with her, and I just remember this, wherever they went in the world, she brought home one photo of a cat to show Christy. Always that. And just all the little individual ways she interacts with the with her grandchildren, and I know with all of you, and with me. So just wanted to thank you guys, everyone here, for supporting us, and especially some of the people that have gone above and beyond the last few months. It's very nice to see. She's done a lot of things in her life. We did a lot of things in her life. But the role that fit her best was grandma. Whether you were her grandkid or not. I think we all know that. So with that, Jordan. Or it's Jen and Jordan.
Am I on? Okay. Sue was the best mother-in-law and grandmother to my kids that I could have wished for. And I am honored to have had her in my life. So caring and compassionate, loyal, fun-loving, funny in her own quirky way. You reminded me, Matt, of a story. I think I was initiated into the TPing culture through the Parricks before Richard and I were even friends, actually. And actually, one funny little story, I wasn't going to tell this, but I can't help it. Pratt's van, as we rolled down their gravel driveway to Parricks' cabin, somehow I got roped into the teepeeing with Pratts, the war between the Parricks and the Pratts, I guess. I don't know. But I ended up in the big red van, I think is what it was. And I'll never forget, we jumped out of the van. We were running towards their cabin, the house, down the gravel drive, and out jumped Sue and Steve and a whole band of people. I don't even know who was there. All I know is we just ran into the woods. That's my little initiation to the Parrick family. But I know that my own pain cannot even begin to compare with Sally, Richard, Mark, Christy, and of course you, Steve. I will always cherish my memories with her. She was an amazing woman with a beautiful legacy. If anyone of you don't know, I'm Jennifer Richard's wife. He cannot be here today. I know that it's hard on him that he cannot be here today, but he has a second family, the Waterfall Group. He is in Alaska, and they have been surrounding him with so much love and support, and I know he will be okay. Those guys are so great, and I'm thankful for them. Apparently they're holding a big barbecue memorial for Sue tonight in her honor, so Alaskan style. But as many of you probably know, Richard has a little bit of a tough shell, But when you get past that shell, he has a huge heart. He's just a big softy. And I know that he really cherished his last moments with his mom and with you, Steve. And he wanted you to know that. Jordan, Richard wrote a letter to his mom, a tribute, and I'd like Jordan to read it for him.
All right, so this is the second draft, and you might all find it on Facebook, but I'll read it here. Might have to take it slow a little bit, but my mom died, and I don't like it. I don't like it at all. At this point, I really don't know what to think or how to deal with it. It bothers me, but it's not just me it bothers. There's my dad, all us kids, my parents' friends, and I know it bothers them all. I'm not angry at God, just saddened that I was not ready for my mom to go. I knew someday this was would happen, but I was not ready yet. I wanted more time just to check in with her, and I can't believe that time is up. The fact that in this lifetime I would never hear her voice again disturbs me. Some days here in Alaska, I'll be on the boat fishing, my guess, and I realize it just hits me. I'll never hear her voice again, and it stops everything. I try to keep going, not to move on because you can't, but you just keep going. There are no bad days, just some you wish you could skip over. As everyone knows, my mom was full of compassion for kids, and I think she preferred to be with some of them over adults. That's a trace I will pass on. She loved all of those grandkids, and all the grandkids of hers were extra special, as well as any kid in her church she could talk to. I always wish my mom could see where I got to work in Alaska. It's an amazing place with awesome people. I love it. Well, now I guess she can look down and see everything. It's all muted right now, but I know that's just from the loss. I love my mom, and I wish I could just tell her one more time, or three. When I found out the end of her life was near, it was a devastating blow. And to tell you the truth, I almost hoped she would go while I was not there. I did not want to see that, but a good buddy and great guide up here in Alaska, Mark, told me I should be there when it happens. When I got home from Alaska, I spent a bunch of time there, but I hoped the last of my mom's breaths I would not witness. As it turns out, I realized while sitting there with my dad in their house, it was about to happen. My mom was moving on from this world to her destined place. I went from uncomfortable to deeply sad, bit peaceful, and I appreciated the opportunity to be with the lady, the mom who gave me my first breath, and to acknowledge her last breath. It's a humbling situation to utter finality for this life as we know it on earth. I did not like it, but appreciated it. I'm so sad I will never ever in my lifetime hear my mom's voice again. It hurts, it bothers me. The woman who sprayed me with the hose when I rode my bike with Cousin Denny after going in a pig pen full of crap. The woman who made the best enchiladas, and the woman who was always concerned about all the chicks I wanted to date. My mom is gone, and I cannot get over it just yet. It bothers me. But I'm glad there is no suffering for her now. I'm glad that she is at peace and filled with joy. And I am glad that she can say hi to my daughter Haley, her mom, and her dad. And I'm glad she is in heaven. My guide friend Colin, one of my favorite people, told me about someone who said something at his mother's funeral. It was, if we had designed it, we wouldn't have designed it this way. Well, we didn't design it, so we have no understanding of these tough and seemingly final situations, even though we know it is not final. I'm just happy one day I'll see my mom again. Until then, though, man, it's not a pity party, but I miss my mom. I'm gonna miss her more, and life will never be the same. And I wish I could hear her voice again. But we go on, we don't move on. We go on and live the life intended for us. And for that, I am grateful. But I will cling to those that I will cling to those I love more and cherish the times with them more and be thankful for any time given. Until I see you again, Mom, love you, and I wish I could see you now, hear your voice. Sadness exists, but hope leads to the knowledge that we'll all be fine, and I'll see you again after my lifetime. Signed, Richard. Uncle Denny.
I'm Sue's favorite brother, and I'm the baby of the family, but she always introduced me as the oldest of the family, because she always had that rib in there, and evidently, you know, got a lot of people saying that. She was quite a person, I think. I think she was at peace with what was happening, because it was happening to her and not to somebody else that she loved. She was really strong. She'd love to still come to church, even if she had to sit in the back room. But most of all, I just wanted to thank Steve for all of us on how he took care of Sue. All he did was look at her, and he knew what she needed or wanted, and did such a good job of taking care of her. He set a high standard that I hope I can achieve, and is a good example to everybody. And I know she appreciated the church family here. So thanks for coming, and we'll all miss her.
I guess I'm going first. So I'm McKenna. These are all the grandkids, minus Gracie, who couldn't make it today. So we're all just going to share some memories that we have. As a lot of people have mentioned, she tried to get to know us in things that we like to do. And so something growing up that I enjoyed even now is like arts and crafts, anything like hands-on, a project, I enjoyed doing that. And so I also enjoyed my American Girl dolls. So one day, I don't know how it came about, but I was over at my grandma's and she handed me a book full of American Girl doll outfits that we could sew. Had all the patterns with it, everything. She gave me the book and said to find one that I wanted to do that we could sew together. So we sewed this little outfit together, and my goodness, this was very hard to sew. It is tiny. I pulled it out of the attic a couple days ago, and I noticed it had ripped, and I stitched it back up, and I just had to sew like 1 inch of the thing, and it was the most frustrating thing ever. So I couldn't imagine, because I'm sure my grandma really did all the work on this outfit, because I'm sure I wasn't that much of a help. But yeah, so that's just one thing I think is special, and it's really cool. Oh, also, a lot of us, she made us all blankets when we were born. She even made one for Walker and Carl Henry when they came from Haiti and Ethiopia. So this is mine. It's very beat up. I think I love mine a lot. So here, I don't know. And none of them were the same. Even I think Lexi has a different one, and I believe we were born like the same year, within the same year. So yeah, I just thought I would show that. And then who wants to go next?
I kind of thought we were all talking, but yeah, I'll just say that, like, for me, Grandma and Grandpa will always live on in the crazy adventures and just seemingly ridiculous things that they've done. I do them myself, and I'll always do them also. And also, I didn't bring my blanket because it's even grosser than McKenna's.
Oh, I got one. I always thought it was cool that I'd call their house for my grandpa, and my grandma would answer, and I'd always call for my grandpa, and she wouldn't get upset or, she wouldn't get hurt or upset because she knew I'd love to talk to my grandpa, but she understood the time we spent together, so. Doesn't make sense, but I can't really talk.
All right, so I have a few things to share kind of for all of us, our experiences. But first, on top of blankets, but every single year for Christmas, we got our grandma pajamas. So she made us each a different pair, different pattern, different fabric, custom to our interests. And we'd go to her house. We barely made it through Christmas dinner before we changed into them. And then we'd usually watch a movie. And so... So these are one of the pairs of pants for the boys, but it was always different, and that we just call them grandma pajamas, and that's pretty much the only ones we wore. So, and I would say as cousins, some of our best memories were at Lake Curlew, and this is our grandma that we know. Thanks, Susie, for the picture. This is 2 years ago this week, and we swam across the lake. And that's what she looks like after. Didn't even phase her. So, and then this is also the grandma we knew. So that's Grandpa. We're in a green Lone Lake. And so that's kind of the grandma we know, we grew up with. And some of my own favorite memories include seeing the Sound of Music in Leavenworth. That was for my 13th birthday. And we all got to do something different for our 13th birthdays that she organized because she's the planner. And thankfully, she gave it to me. And then, so one thing that stands out to me is this book, okay? So a while ago, when I was younger, I had charm bracelets. She gave them names because they got left in Grandpa's coat pocket while I was at some sort of practice. And then, so she took pictures everywhere she went because I couldn't get this thing back. It went up to BC, it went to London. This bracelet went to Rome. While Grandpa would go to work, so while Grandpa's at work, she would tell right where she went with the bracelet, just she and the bracelet. And then it went to the McMahon house, I guess, and then all the way back to Seattle where I got it like a month later. So I've had fun looking through it and seeing her handwriting. Anything else? Oh, last but not least, when we think of our grandma, we think of the Incredibles. We would go to Kalaloc every year camping and go to Ruby Beach, our favorite beach ever. And we would be in the car for 4 hours. Sorry, Grandpa, saying Ruby Beach for 4 hours. And we did it for a lot of years. And she would pack food for us. We loved it because we got to have whatever pop we wanted, sugar, cookies, whatever, for those like 3 days. And we got to watch The Incredibles there and back every single year. And we memorized it. And we turned the volume off, and we all had parts, and we can do the whole movie. So I didn't bring the picture, but 3 weeks ago, we all went as cousins to watch the second one. And we took a really cool selfie, and we wish she could have been there with us. So thank you.
We'd like to sing some songs with you or have you sing with us, okay? In honor of Sue. And just a couple of choruses that I know that she enjoyed. Stand up. Why don't you? You've been sitting a while. Yeah, stand up. And let's sing In Christ Alone. I know that was the embodiment of Sue. She lived her life in Christ alone in so many ways that we have heard already. So again, we just want to honor Sue and sing a couple of songs here. So join us. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, burned through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross where Jesus died, the wrath of God was justified, for every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me, from life's first cry till final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
That brought my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed.
My
chains are gone.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending amazing grace.
The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long.
Chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever.
Years
when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun.
We've no less days.
We've no less days
to sing God's praise.
To sing God's praise.
And when we first began.
And when we first begun.
Amen. Amen. Good job.
You guys may be seated. Thank you, Iverson family. So the family's asked me to just host some time. A brief time of sharing. They want about 5 to 7 people to share a little bit about what Sue meant for them. So we're going to take this time to do this briefly, and I'll kick it off. I came to the island 3 years ago, and Sue and Steve were one of the first people that I met. My responsibilities here at the church, I'm one of the pastors here at the church, is overseeing the life groups. And they were life group leaders. And if you ever wanted life group leaders to lead and make people feel welcome. And if you don't know what life groups are, they're like smaller groups within the church that meet together to do Bible study or something like that. These folks were just exemplary. They were welcoming. They had good questions. Steve challenged me. He's like, these questions are boring. We need better questions at the time. He's like, we don't want to rehash the sermon. We want application, application. And that's the word that pops to me when I think about Steve and Sue. They were about the application. How do we do this and not just talk about it? So those are the things that pop out to me about Steve and Sue. And Sue did that in practical ways. They watched our kids. They came over, did different things. And thank you for welcoming me. And I appreciate Sue for that as well. So what we'll like to do is have about 5 to 7 people share briefly. And just a little bit of a kind of housekeeping deal. We're live streaming this, so I'm going to hold on to the microphone so that we make sure we get it properly into the live stream. So if you could just meet me in the aisle, that would be great. So yeah, let's have about 5 to 7 people share. It looks like Claire wants to share. Claire, do you?
So I'm one of those kids they took in, kind of, as Sue would say, she's my second mom. I'm Richard's friend, and if I'm on the island, it's their fault. But Sue knew a lot of ways to reach out and to love on me and bring them into their house, even when it was just a RV in the undeveloped lot. Or bring me an Easter basket, because my parents said I was too old for an Easter basket. So Sue brought one to church over in Linwood, where I grew up. So we go way back. But just her ability to be hospitable in a situation anytime, or to host people, that she taught me as not one of her kids, but one of the kids that became part of the family and know a lot of the family because I was included in a lot of things. And that is impressed on my life forever, to host people. And whether it's you're in the middle of a garage and you are cooking on an electric skillet and you can cook an amazing meal that, I'm sorry to my own mother, but Sue could cook much better. And so taught me how to cook and just love on people through food and for hosting and just the way she reached out and loved me, to the point where even when I met Shelley, it was important for me to get on a ferry and bring him over to Steve and Sue so that she could they could meet my future wife. And that was so important because they treated me as one of their kids, and they've treated many other people. I know friends in Alaska that they used to make enchiladas every day before youth group, and I think people just liked eating their food too, but they enabled youth workers like my brother and Keith Hamilton and people like that. They just knew how to come alongside and make their lives count and make ministry important.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Christy. I got to know Sue and Steve while we were teaching Sunday school, and year after year, they just consistently volunteered. Their kids were getting older, but they still continued to volunteer in Sunday school, and I was so appreciative of that. But the thing that I really remember about Sue is when we were over in the chicken house that used to be the church, we were there, and we were taking a class, and it was by Dobson, and it was on parenting, and I was sitting next to Sue, and she kind of started sniffling a little bit, and I thought, I wonder what's going on there, and then pretty soon she was sniffling a lot harder, and I thought, what is wrong? And then pretty soon she was sobbing, and I said, Sue, what is wrong? And she said, the biggest blessing I've ever been given is my husband and my kids, and I so just want to follow God's way, and I really want them to follow the Lord and train them up in the way they should go, and when they are old, they will not depart from it. And she just, her heart towards her family and her kids just touched me so much. And I just had my first child, and I thought, gosh, I hope that I can remember this. And that was 30-something years ago, and I still remember it. It touched my heart so deeply. She was so compassionate, so loving, and as she said, her family was her greatest gift, the thing that blessed her the most, and she wanted to please God by doing what was right in her family and for her children. And I praise God for that. Thank you.
Thank you. All right.
Hi, my name's Steve. We've been here at the Island Church since the very early 1980s, and to my recollection, Steve and Sue were always here. That may not be true, but we certainly became acquainted and very close friends with them, very soon. And they were a little ahead on the journey than my wife Dee and I were, a little bit older, a little further along in their jobs and raising the family and those sorts of things. And they became mentors to us and someone that we could look to for inspiration and advice on a lot of the issues, you know, you deal with at that stage of your life. And I just appreciate Sue and, of course, Steve very much, and love them both deeply. Specifically to Sue, at one point in time, a child evangelism fellowship person was here at the church, and that was a relative of Sue's, I'm not exactly sure who. But he handed out prayer cards for the kids, and I took this card of a little boy, you know, and I was talking to Sue about it later, and I said, well, how long do I keep praying for this little boy? And she very matter-of-factly said, well, forever. So Sue was just a wonderful, wonderful person. The only consolation to her passing is, of course, that she's with the Lord, and we can rejoice greatly in that. Thank you.
I'm Tracy Thrasher Woods, and 45 years ago, I was one of those kids who was blessed to be loved by Sue and Steve, and we were displaced because we had moved from Seattle to Everett, and I remember Sally and Christy and Richard, you know, the little kids, and it was just amazing because Sue and Steve just opened their home, you know, and it didn't matter what was happening in the house. The kids are running around and stuff, but they really impacted me with being in the Word, you know, having a Bible study with us, teaching us that you can laugh and love and learn and be in Christ. And just that impacted me for my life of how I would live out too. And I never really knew who to blame for short shooting beds, but I learned from her. So now I know. But I'm just really thankful and thankful that we will see her again.
My name is Heidi, and I'm a niece by marriage. And I just want to thank you, Uncle Steve, that you and Sue, when my husband and I were going through a difficult time, you gave us our first Bible. I was a recipient of one of those. It wasn't a King James. And I think there's a New Living Translation, so I could actually understand it. And there's a note in there just telling us to read Mark and then Matthew and then John. And I was thinking, wow, you don't have to start at the beginning. If it hadn't been for you two, I never would have gotten past Leviticus. But all it took was reading the book of John and the first paragraph, and that's when I gave Jesus my life. I never knew what a relationship with Jesus would be like. I didn't even really know you could have one, but
God showed us the way.
Amen. Praise God. Let's have two more.
I'm Jeremy, and I grew up in this church, Jeremy Iverson. I can still picture myself doing GT up here on this stage. GT and the Halo Express, grew up in kids' choir. Have a lot of good history with the Parrick family, and from being in Christine John's wedding to Mark babysitting me and my three siblings, and building forts in the living room. My mom and dad were out and away, and they come back, and he gave us all nicknames, too. It was pretty fun. And it's just instilled. You can see Sue and Steve's legacy living in their kids and in their grandkids. So many fun memories from everything. We would host, our family would always have a big gingerbread house making time during the Christmas season, and Sue and Steve were always invited. And it usually ended in some sort of a prank being played. One I specifically remember was Sue. I don't know. I think my mom made fun of Steve's lack of hair up here. And so Sue's like, okay, you're going to get my boy. I'm going to get you back. So we didn't know this till I think it was the next day. But my mom goes to use the restroom the next morning or something. And she had saran wrapped the toilet so it looked like it was clear, and my mom sits down and what the heck is going on? That darn Parrick. So thank you, Sue, for instilling that in us and just the fun, loving spirit she had. Recently, we had a great time. Sue and Steve, I don't know if many of you know this, but like I think Matt mentioned it in the riding of the bikes, they would ride forever, and they rode across Iowa. My wife and I live out in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, which is right there next to Iowa. And Sue and Steve came through and hung out with us for a few days. It was a blessing. They loved on our daughter. We only had one child at the time, our daughter, but Sue was just in her grandma mode like she always is, and immediately just became a grandmother to my daughter, who had never even met her. In the 3 days that she was there, maybe one or 2 days, but they rode across Iowa. And if you didn't know, I think I was in a record heat wave index. It was like 120 degrees, was it not? Like you survived. I was seriously scared that they weren't going to make it. I'm like, guys, just please don't do this. This is not a good idea. But they made it. They came back through. And Steve helped me. We had some water in the basement, and we had to get all of that out months before. And I was putting the basement back together, and Steve was there, the handyman that he is, teaching me how to use a coping saw and how to cope the edges and put my trim back down on my baseboard and my floor. So many memories, and I'm just so thankful from them teaching Sunday school, the faithful servants they are. I felt like if there's one phrase I could wrap Sue up in is, if you want to be great in God's kingdom, you got to learn to be a servant of all. And she served, and she was a servant leader. And so I just thank you so much for that legacy you left, Sue. We love you so much.
Let's have one more. Nobody wants to? All right, we'll have the Hanos come up.
Well, we're from Iowa. we're Dean and Susie Hano. We've just been here since I retired 7 years ago. And according to Steve, we always sit on that side. They sat on that side. And according to Steve, Sue pointed over there and said, hey, we have to get to be friends with that couple over there. And they did. They welcomed us into this church, and they welcomed us into their home. They welcomed us into their lives. So we were thankful for that. We became part of that small group that they hosted and felt very welcome there. Sue, in the privacy of our small group, we knew if she was praying for us, that's the person you wanted to pray for you. So we were thankful for her. And I know where she is now. But Steve, I know that right now her being gone feels very permanent. So we grieve with you.
The thing that really impressed me in these last months was the peace that Sue had. She never complained. She just she said over and over, I want what the Lord wants for me. And that really spoke to me that she was living out her faith when the going gets tough. And I heard her cry out a few times, and what she said was, Lord, help me. And that was a huge testimony to me. And I know if you're here today, you're probably here because you love Sue. And I know if you're here today, Sue loved you. And the thing that would make bless her heart the most is to see you on the other side. So I guess I would just say, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus like Sue did, that you should talk to one of her family members and get that straight, because this isn't the end. And she wants to see you in glory.
Amen. Thank you very much. Let's hit that slideshow.
Smile says it all. second tries. Maybe we've been living with our eyes half open. Maybe we're bent and broken. Broken.
My heart. All right. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for the blessing that Sue was to all of us, Lord. And we just pray, Lord, that as we leave here, Lord, that we would leave just remembering, like Dick said, Lord, all the great things about her life, Lord. I pray that as we go from this place, that your presence would go with us, Lord. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.